हेलो ऑल, दिस इज डॉक्टर ज्योति के बी, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर, गवर्नमेंट फर्स्ट ग्रेड कॉलेज कुबी। टुडेज सेशन इज सेशन 41। इट गिव्स इंट्रोडक्शन टू योर प्रिस्क्राइब्ड क्रिटिकल एसे बायोग्राफिया लिटरेरिया व्हिच इज रिटन बाय कॉलरिज। नाउ एज यू ऑल नो, कॉलरिज, वर्ड्सवर्थ, शेली, कीट्स एंड बायरन form the five major romantic poets of English literature. We are studying one of the important critical work which formed the foundation for the origin of great romantic poetry. Now let us see what Coleridge has to tell us about poetry, difference between poetry and prose. What is the difference between a poet and an ordinary man? So what are the basic elements which form poetry? All these things in this session as described by Coleridge in his critical essay Biographia Literaria. So now what we are studying is the preface to his book, anthology of his production. The preface talks about what are his ideas, what are his subjects, what are his perspectives regarding poetry. So let us learn in detail what he has got to say about poetry in his preface to his anthology of poems in the book called Biographia Literaria. So in this session we are talking about basic concepts of romantic criticism. In this session we want you to understand Coleridge as a great critic through brief introduction to his works. Now you see a picture of Coleridge on the screen. He was born on 21st October 1772 and died on 25th July 1834. The written monument of Coleridge's critical work is contained in 24 chapters of Biographia Literaria. So you might be asked with a MCQ. So how many chapters are contained in Biographia Literaria? So then you have to write 24 chapters. In this critical disquisition, Coleridge concerns himself not only with the practice of criticism, but also with its theory. In chapter 14 of Biographia Literaria, so you are prescribed with chapter 14 out of 24 chapters which is written in the book called Biographia Literaria. So in this chapter, what is prescribed for you, Coleridge's views on nature and function of poetry is discussed in philosophical terms. Coleridge discusses the difference between poetry and prose and function of poetry in this chapter. He insists that every work of art is an organic whole. Coleridge rules out the assumption that poetry's function is to make men morally better. So, for the first time, he is declaring that the aim of poetry, the objective of poetry, is not to correct human beings, but to give delight, joy, and through that delight and joy, you also get the message. So giving the message itself is not the objective of poetry, is the idea which Coleridge emphasizes in his book. Now he talks about two important points of poetry. Coleridge begins his chapter with the views on two cardinal points of poetry. To him, two cardinal points are: A, the power of exciting sympathy of reader by a faithful adherence to the truth of nature. So Coleridge identifies two aims of writing poetry. One is to evoke or to motivate the sympathy of his of the reader. Means sympathy is where you sympathize, where you feel somebody else as you itself. So you have the sense of compassion, You have sense of kindness and passion towards somebody else. So that is sympathy. So the poetry should make somebody to be sympathetic towards something else. Maybe it is an object or a thing. And what is the means of giving sympathy or evoking sympathy in the reader, listener, or the onlooker is that you strictly adhere to true human nature. So if you depict or if you portray or picturize a real human being, naturally human beings will have sympathy towards the character which is brought out in the poem, novel or short story. So to bring out sympathy is the one aim of poetry according to Coleridge, and he identifies the aim of poetry. First aim of poetry is to bring sympathy in the reader. Then he talks about second aim. So second point in for the reason for which the poem is written, second reason is to give interest of poetry by modifying with the colors of imagination. So with the help of imagination, what you do is you create something different, something supernatural, something unique, which is beyond the common logical understanding of the world. So to create something beyond human nature is the second aim of poetry according to Coleridge. So there are two aims or two objectives in which Coleridge looks into poetry. Two aims. First one is to evoke sympathy in the reader, and the means to arrive at the aim is to depict everything as it is in the ordinary world. So whatever exists in the world, if you fix yourself to the true human nature and you write or picturize or describe or narrate an ordinary situation, the listeners, the onlookers or the viewers will certainly get sympathy towards that object. That is one aim. Second aim is to take the audience, to take the listeners away from the ordinary life. And what is the means or what is the way in which you take the audience away from their ordinary life is to use the faculty of imagination. So two objectives he discusses in the beginning of the essay, chapter 14. According to him, it was decided that Wordsworth would write poetry dealing with the theme of first cardinal point, and the other was to be dealt by him. So as we know, Coleridge and Wordsworth were great friends, and both of them decided to write poetry, and Wordsworth thought of the first method of writing poetry. Coleridge tried to adopt the second cardinal point of writing poetry, which we discussed just now. For the first type of poetry, the treatment and subject matter should be, to quote Coleridge, "the sudden charm which accidents of light and shade, which moonlight or sunset diffused over a known and a familiar landscape, appear to represent the practicality of combining both. These are poetry of nature." So first method, Coleridge talks about writing poetry is to write poetry of nature. So how to write poetry of nature? You stick to the ordinary life, but to that ordinary life you are mixing certain charm and a uniqueness, a grace which you bring into ordinary life. So this he calls poetry of nature. In such poems, subjects were to be chosen from ordinary life. In the second type of poetry, the incident and the agents were to be supernatural. In this sort of poetry, to quote Coleridge, the excellence aimed at was to consist in the interesting of the affections. by the dramatic truth of such emotions as would naturally accompany such situations, supposing them real. So he wants poets, the persons who like to adopt the second point, second way of writing poetry, he wants people to use the emotions which are common in a particular context or a particular environment, to use those emotions to the dramatic truth. So to use the emotions of a particular context and to play on that emotions to in order to make them truthful, and the jugglery with the emotions will make the poem something graceful, something unique, and at the same time something real. So he wanted to mix both in the second kind of poetry. And real in the sense they have been to every human being who from whatever course of delusion has at any time believed himself under supernatural agency. So he wanted to create situations in which there are above conscious or beyond conscious levels of context. Maybe the character which he has portrayed himself is in a state of beyond consciousness, delusion, or an insane situation, and something which is not normal, which is extraordinary, is happening around him. So when somebody is portrayed like this, the readers who are reading or viewing such scenes will certainly believe that what is on the screen is real, because the person, the character who is portrayed himself is in a state of delusion. So creating unconsciousness within the consciousness, within the ordinary life, and to bring certain charm and grace to such creations, such portrayals, is what Coleridge is aiming at. Thus with the help, and how does he do? He does it with the help of the faculty of imagination. Thus, with the help of imagination, the natural will be dealt supernaturally by the poet, and the reader will comprehend it with willing suspension of disbelief. So basically, he creates contexts where there are ordinary situations, ordinary contexts, and the characters are in an unconscious state or an overconscious state or subconscious state, or he is creating a situation in which the contexts themselves are unnatural, where there are natural, real human beings. So this kind of situations will allow the readers to suspend their logic, suspend their rationality, and still they believe that what is happening on the screen is real. So these kind of combinations and methods were used by Coleridge, and that is how he talks about in his essay. Then he talks about the difference between prose and poetry. According to him, the poem contains the same elements as a prose composition, but the difference is between the combination of those elements and objects aimed at in both the composition. So both are same, but the way the elements are combined is different. To Coleridge, superaddition of meter does not make a poem. In order to deserve the name of a poem, each part of the composition, including meter, rhyme, diction, and theme, must harmonize with the wholeness of the composition. So meter itself will not make good poems. The different elements of poems, like theme, audience, tone, mood, point of view, all these together should form a whole which will give a new sense of meaning. So if all these combine together to an organic whole to bring out a new thought or new message or new meaning, only then it can be called as a poem. Mere meter will not make a poem, according to Coleridge. A poem is a species of composition which is opposed to works of science by proposing for its immediate object pleasure, not truth. And from all other species, it is discriminated by proposing to itself such delight from the whole as is compatible with a distinct gratification from each component. Now, he talks about the difference between poem and science. Now, what is the difference between science and poem? So, science end result is truth, while poem's end result is pleasure. And the poem gives delight from the whole, not individual. One element is perfect while other elements are not combining together. Meter, so elements of poetry, as you know in the introduction, the poem's basic elements are mood, tone, meter, rhyme, rhythm, theme, subject. So all these are elements of poem, and every element would combine with the other to form a complete delightful object, and it gives delight from the whole, not individual, or not one perfection of meter itself will not make it a good poem. So delight is the end of poetry, truth is the end of science. Then he talks about the difference between prose and poetry. The immediate object of prose is to give truth, of a poem is to give pleasure. So like science, science is written in prose, so the end of science is truth. Similarly, the end of prose is truth, while poem gives delight. Coleridge writes, the reader should be carried forward not merely by the mechanical impulse of curiosity or by the restless desire to arrive at the final solution, but by the pleasurable activity of mind excited by the attraction of the journey itself. So the reader should not just become interested, he just should not wait for the end. Every part of it, every serial of it, every individual item within it should give pleasure, and every point should make him stay at that point, enjoy the moment, then go for the next line of action. So that kind of poem is called a good poem. So whether it is prose, whether it's a novel or a short story, if it has these qualities, even if it doesn't have meter, it can be called as poetry. In scientific and historical composition, the immediate purpose is to convey truth. The prose works like romances and novels give pleasure in the immediate purpose, and the ultimate end may be to give truth. Thus, the communication of pleasure may be the immediate object of work, not metrically composed. Then he talks about the difference between poem and poetry. So I think as the time duration for the session is about 15 minutes, and as this session and the video session is going beyond it, so I shall stop at this, and I will continue in my next session on the same topic, and I shall sum up what all we have described just now in 3 or 4 slides. So I shall stop at this for 41 session. Please listen to session 42, and it will be the continuation of this session. So thank you very much for listening to this session, and stay back for the 42nd session of Biographia Literaria.